but you are really uprooted. You don't. You are not solidary enough with the state of Israel. You are really too cosmopolitic. You don't have roots. You are not identified with your community. You think only about commercial success and so on and so on. In other words, what did shock me is how the Zionist critique of those Jews who do not solidarize fully with the state of Israel takes over precisely all the standard clichés, main clichés in the West against the Jews. If you don't believe me, do something. Go on the internet and look on the www.masada2000.org/list-a. It's a Zionist website where you get the list of what they call self-hating Jews. It's a shocking document. Why? Because first, the term they used is something like a self-hating internal terrorist, shit. Like, they call them shit. Point two, and you find there many of our friends, Judith Butler is there, of course, Avital Ronel, 4,000. What shocked me is that every person is described in an extremely aggressive way. The photo chosen is usually one that makes you look like a freak, ridiculous. And on the top of it, wherever they could have got it, you have an email address, a solicitation to hate mail, of course. But the impression is really, my God, we are back at the, like anti-Semitic, you know, the list of shitty Jews. It's precisely the same logic. So again, here we have the problem with the neighbor and so on. So if you allow me just 3 minutes more, I would like to conclude with a question which maybe bothers you. So does this mean we should just, in a kind of a Levinasian way, respect our neighbors, no universality, just let's keep a distance and so on? No, there is a positive universal ethics which does take into account this. What kind of ethics? Ethics, I would say, without morality. But this, I don't mean the Nietzschean point, when morality means how you relate to others and ethics means are you faithful to yourself, to your existential choice and so on. I mean something else. For me, to use Schiller's opposition of naive and sentimental, morality is sentimental. You do something, but you feel good doing it, no? Like, you know, when you pay for charity for the African kids, you think, isn't it nice? There is a happy kid there because I sent him $10 a month, whatever. Ethics is much more ruthless. And I would like just to finish to give you a brief example. You find it in the bookstores, one of the defining novels for me, by a Hungarian writer, now an old lady who emigrated from Hungary in 56, Agota Christov. I like the name. It looks as if some stupid Eastern European mispronounced Agatha Christie, no? She wrote a trilogy, The Notebook, The Proof, the Third Lie. It tells the story of two young boys, twins, living with their grandmother in a small Hungarian border town during the last years of the World War II and the early years of communism. These twins are absolutely immoral. They lie, blackmail, kill, but I think they stand for absolute ethics. Let me give you a couple of examples. One day they meet in a forest a starved deserter and bring him some things he asked them for. Then that's their narration. When we come back with the food and blanket, he, the deserter, says, "You are very kind." We say, "We weren't trying to be kind. We've brought you these things because you absolutely need them. That's all." I think this is a wonderful, truly Christian ethical stance. You just do what is needed. You don't do it because it's good. You do it because the other needs it, because it has to be done. And no matter what the other asks you, for example, one night, the twins find themselves sleeping in the same bed with a German officer, a tormented gay masochist. Early in the morning, the twins awaken and want to leave bed. But the officer holds them back. Dialogue. "Don't move. Keep sleeping," says the officer. The boys said, "We want to urinate. We have to go." "Don't go. Do it here." We ask, "Where?" He says, "On me. Yes, don't be afraid. Piss on my face." We do it. Then we go out into the garden because the bed is all wet. Like, totally cold, normal. The guy wants to piss on his face. What's the problem? Why not? This is the true work of love, I think. Then the twins' closest friend is the priest's housekeeper, a young, voluptuous woman who washes them and their clothes, plays erotic games with them, and so on. Then something happens when a procession of starved Jews is led through the town on their way to the camp. One of the Jews asks them, please, bread. The housekeeper, the young girl, shows a little bit of bread, then smiles and eats herself the bread. The boys decide to punish her. They stole from the German officer a little bit of munition and put into the kitchen stove so that her face explodes and disfigures her. It's considered a simple ethical act. I would have done absolutely the same. Then the two brothers blackmail the good priest because they have a young girl who is harassed by the whole village, poor girl, and the girl needs help to survive. So what do? They go to the priest and said, we heard the story that you were once playing with a small girl. The priest said, it's not true. And the boys said, we don't care, but the girl needs money, so if you don't give us so much money every week, we will tell this to the whole village. Then the priest said, I quote it, it's monstrous. Have you any idea what you are doing? The boys answer, yes, sir, we are blackmailing you. At your age, it's deplorable. The boys answer, yes, it's deplorable that we've been forced to do this. But Herlip, the girl, and her mother absolutely need money. I would do the same. There is nothing personal in this blackmail. Later, they even become close friends with the priest. And when the girl can survive on her own, learns to work and so on, they go to the priest and said, thanks very much, now we no longer need any money. They tell the priest, quote, keep it, you have given enough. We took your money when it was necessary. Now we earn enough money to give some to Herlip, to the girl. We have also taught her to work. And the same when the mother, the grandmother asked them to kill her, they kill her and so on. That's where I stand. If you would ask me what kind of ethics I would like to follow, it's precisely this, an ethical monster without empathy, doing simply the duty to help others with blind spontaneity, but without any narcissistic self-satisfaction. I claim that with more people like these two monstrous children, the world would have been a pleasant place to stay. It is only in such a world that we would be really alive. You know, the old religious question, is there life after death? Wolf Biermann, the German, in the old days, dissident poet, has a wonderful poem where he asks the true question. He says the true question is not, is there life after death, but is there life before death? And his answer is, okay, only with certain attitude and so on. And I think these two children, with their ruthless, brutal ethics, you do it. It's needed, you blackmail the priest. It's needed, you kill. Friend asks you to piss on his face. What's the problem? You do it. That's what I would like to be. Thanks very much. Now we can pretend that we are in a democracy, no, for some time.
So we have approximately half an hour for questions. And so I would like to ask everybody to make them as short as possible so that we can have as many people as possible asking the questions, okay? Thank you.
Very enjoyable.
Go to butt directly. Yeah.
No, I don't have a butt. I have a question. When you think about fundamentalism, is it big other? Or
no?
Is it no?
Almost the opposite.
Opposite. Okay.
Is this the question? Mm-hmm. Or you want to elaborate it?
No, I want you to elaborate it, because if you look at...
By fundamentalism, you mean what we usually mean by fundamentalism, so-called religious fundamentalism or what?
That's only one of many, so I don't know. No, I'll leave it up
to you. Which are the others for you? No, I just want to get the location of your question.
Well, there's fundamentalisms. I mean, there's a kind of a secular fundamentalism that you saw in the 50s, maybe in Eastern Europe.
Yeah,
so, I mean, there's different ones, but I think people think about religious fundamentalism. Do you have a theory or an account of the rise of it in the 70s?